I wanted to ask Alex first, I mean, before we even get into questions, what was it that you would want to say?
Hello.
Perfect.
It's a beautiful day. Earlier this morning, I got to see the paper, and there's a lot said in there. And it's a truth that come into being in the art world. When I first came here in 1965, I was on my way to New York City to become a famous artist. I stopped here to check out in my Indian department, see what they were really doing, what they were up to. And I found out they had a whole department that did nothing much for the Indians. And so I decided, well, I better change that. And it just so happened at that point, the Expo 67 was happening in Montreal, and they needed expert advice. And I got hired, so I didn't go to New York. And I became an advisor to the team that was putting the Indian Pavilion together. And I always thank God because I was able to give advice, good advice to the team that was building the Indian Pavilion. And they were crossing over some of the sacred things, and I was able to stop that, and they could adjust or rechange the building in such a way that it didn't offend the native people. And that was the beginning. I love that job because it gave me a lot of freedom. I used to go to Montreal, spend the whole week there with the Expo 67 building. And then I would come back to Ottawa. You know, there was a train that would come here. And then I would go back, change clothes, and I'd run back to Montreal for a weekend of fun, you know. And I guess I don't have to tell you Easterners what that happened. But it was fun. You know, it was something engaging. I was young, so I love that part. But the part that was important was my contribution to the building of the Indian Pavilion at Expo. And upon my advice, with the help of some of the elders, the old Chief Commando was a lot of help. He was a good advisor. I got to know him. And a few of the Mohawks in Kahnawake, they too provided insight, information about our people and the people in Eastern Canada. And it didn't matter at that point what part of Canada the natives came from. We were all suffering at the command of what we would call the Department of Indian Affairs. They would unilaterally control every native. And I'd like to just point out one thing here, which may be a surprise to a lot of you. We had to get a pass, a written pass, to go from point A to point B. And it had to be signed by an Indian agent. And And years later, we found out there was no such law. We were made to carry these papers around, you know, written permission to go somewhere. And that prevented natives from advancing into anything, even to go to university. I'm bringing this up because in my art world, I was privately tutored, and I knew quite a bit about art already when I was young. I applied for entrance into a university in London, England, and I was accepted. But the Department of Indian Affairs wouldn't give me the permit to go. They stopped it. So I applied to another university, which was Ontario College of Art. And again, I was told that I wasn't... These people that go there, he says, they're very intelligent. They're more intelligent than you are, you know. That's the words of the Indian agent. So he registered me to the Southern Alberta Institute of Technology and Art. And I completed my 4 years there. And I passed with honors. And that's why that gives me a little go ahead in the art world. It got me to wedge my way through this whole system. And I mean wedge through. Nobody really welcomed me, so I had to enter into the art world. The only thing that really, really helped me is just a paintbrush. That was my most powerful weapon that I could use. And in fact, if I ever die, if I'm gonna die, I want, instead of a cross, I want a paintbrush in my coffin. And now with this show here, I don't know, maybe I'll put something else in rather than a paintbrush, you know. With a powerful show here at the Art Gallery of Ontario. There was no dream in 65 that I would successfully have a show in my lifetime in a great institute of the art in Canada.
It always moves me, and I can't say it that it surprises me, but to hear you talk about your experiences in the art world, in the political world, in working on the Indians of Canada Pavilion, that we're talking about worlds that are extremes, the experiences that are extremes, that you know, you've lived through, survived residential schools, and then going on to be, take an advisory, an instrumental role in the formation of the Indians of Canada Pavilion, which is a watershed moment in Indigenous history in the world. It's the first time that Aboriginal peoples in Canada had an international voice to speak to the world, to tell the world our history from our own perspective, and that's huge. What is it that carried you through all the trials, the hardships, and then, you know, to here?
I think if I was to answer that, I would base it on the strength of my family, my parents. My father was a traditional chief, and my mother was non-educated, but she was educated the native way. We had the language, we had our access to the environment, and I learned a lot from her. And just to give you an idea how my education was like, you know these little birds that have these little eggs in a, there, it's a blue color robins. Eggs. And,
robins.
And they're beautiful, beautiful birds. And I was going to, she showed me where the nest was. And it was about four or five blue eggs in there. And she cautioned me not to breathe or to touch. If I did that, she would leave those eggs because it's contaminated. And that's the kind of education I received from my mother. I don't know if I answered anything, you know.
I think you provide many, many answers. And it takes, we have to listen to you and then process a lot of what you say. So maybe a simple question, or maybe it isn't a simple question, but it's we talked a little bit about why you make art and where it comes from, how it gets you to where you are. How about the circle and the idea of the circle? How can circles figure so prominently in your work, both as a form, but also within works?
Well, the circle in the native world, you know, we have the four directions, of course, but in there we have the everything rotates in a circle form. You know, even the seasons work that way. You know? And the sun, I heard, goes around. I used to think that, but apparently it's just the earth spinning around, and it keeps coming back to the, in the morning, it spins back to the morning, you know. And when I was a kid, I thought, my gosh, that sun must be fast. You know, I sleep one night and it makes it circle, you know. And that's, when I went to the residential school, it was a confusing place. Used to try to figure things like that out, you know, because they would give you information like a standard way of education, and in a native way, you're including everything, every part of the, you know, the sky, the earth, and the. The movement of the sun and the moon and so on. When you live close to nature, I still do that. We still do that. Live close to the lake and close to the elemental world. But at that time, the most important thing was the spiritual side of what the elders were trying to inform us to live under these information. They now call it Indian culture. I don't know what that is exactly, because that confused us with the East Indians too, you know. And we know we're all human beings, but you know, we've been named a lot of names. Now I'm Aboriginal. I'm not even black enough yet to be from South Africa or somewhere, or Australia. But it's just titles, you know, human titles. I don't know what I'll be next. I hope they don't call us white people. Because that's going to be a hard one to follow up to. Thank you.
Painting in a circle, okay.
I went full circle.
Yeah. If we can continue on with the idea of the circle, and there's the philosophical side, the spiritual side, but also there must be, or is there, even just a practical side, a compositional side, that, you know, working with a circle as opposed to working with a square, or a rectangle, a rectangular sheet of paper or a canvas, must alter your approach and composition.
One of the things I have learned from Carlo Altenberg, the immigrant professor at the University of Alberta, he spotted me and he took me under his wing for about 3 summers, got private tutoring. And some of the things he taught me was the divisions of 68 parts to 37 and 20, or 21. And they made studies of the Greek temples and so on, and those numbers come in into those temples. And that's where they probably got the numbers from. But in all your art, those numbers, no matter how you use the pictorial thing, those numbers all behave accordingly so that your eye is pleasantly pleased with those divisions. I also had the information that he believed, this Altenberg, that we only have as human beings a space of color between the alpha and the omega. We're allowed to see all the colors in between that, so that area. But he believed that beyond that, beyond alpha, the animals can see, and omega, the animals can see. And he believed that at some point in our development, of our visionary development, we may be able to see beyond, you know, the color spectrum of the 8-color system, or the colors that we're used to. I went to art school with that kind of knowledge, you know. And I remember I've had a lot of talks with some of these professors. They thought I knew something, you know. I was just a kid from out in the bush, you know. But I had these other information that I was able to absorb through the help of Carlo Altenberg, and that made a big, big difference in my life. I was able to, you know, understand what I was studying, you know, through color and through the dimensions of divisions and so on. I didn't have to learn that all over. I already had that when I went to art school. So I was always ahead of my class, and but the professors, they were always trying to snip something away from me, you know. They thought I knew a lot. Actually, I faked a lot of it too, you know. I wasn't equally that smart, you know.
I think that we may all be the same species, but that some of us definitely have the ability to see more than others. and you would be one of those people. You told me that story of viewing the night sky and going deep into the night sky, different levels, and out of that observation comes some of the works in the space series, and that was fascinating to me. I wonder, you know, in the teachings that you've been able to bring into yourself to assimilate from Western art history through Carl Altenberg and Marion Nicol with the ideas of automatic drawing from the subconscious. There's a lot of that in the record about how important those influences are to you. But do you want to talk a little bit about some of those other early influences? With at the opening, you specifically gave credit to the elderly ladies in your youth. Well, I'm thinking of beadwork and quill work, the beadwork and quill work designs, and how those come up in your artwork.
I would like to think that I was really learning through the systems with those influential people. And I was lucky to do that. The part that I haven't brought up was the knowledge of the old people, the elders of my tribe. These people lived off the land. They studied everything because their survival was based on that. When I walk along the lake in Cold Lake, which my friend here has.
There happens to be a photo of you there, right behind us.
Yeah, that's the one. That's the shoreline. That's just one of the little places in the old big lake. Anyway, there's every part of that shoreline. It's like a classroom. At different seasons, you know, you have almost a different lecture. Winter time, you have another lecture. Like springtime, the colors are starting to come back in, and the birds are returning, and all of a sudden, life comes around back to the way it should be. And then towards fall, all of a sudden you hear these canada geese, they come in huge flocks, and then you hear them in the air, and followed by the white goose and other birds that go south. And so the fall time, the color change. And I've been in Eastern Canada. You have lovely, lovely color changes in the maple trees and all the other type of trees. And I was able to have that fortune to see that too. So I've not only seen Canada in the West, I've seen a bit of the eastern color. And so some of those colors are, you'll see them in my paintings. Yeah.
Maybe we'll switch to a very different note just for a minute and take one of the questions that came in through social media, and that's from Cal, and I think he's a younger person, who's asking about skateboarding and skateboarding culture. So he says, skateboarding hails from surfing, an indigenous, in quotes, creation. Many youth find escape in skating, skateboarding in remote suicide-stricken reservations. Would you ever consider painting or designing a skateboard? And then he has in brackets, for example, mine.
I think that would call for a straight line with some colors.
Could be
while on a flight, you know.
That'll be your next commission. I think, but there's a very serious side to your work as well, in the way that you deal with environmental issues, with politics, and a lot of that is really encapsulated in the idea of landlordship. And I wonder if you wanted to explain what that means. What does it mean when you say it's time for the Indians to become the landlords again?
Politics, what's that? Only in Ottawa, I guess. I have named some of the paintings in issue of, you know, social issues of my tribe and your tribe, you know. The two tribes don't seem to get together too well sometimes. And so there's awareness of discord and also agreements, you know. So it's a Canadian thing, you know. I notice that people come from different parts of Europe or something like that. They don't even get along, you know. And they expect us Indians to get along all together, you know. And we're all different tribes, too. So in similarity, I guess, you know, the issues of survival on this Mother Earth is almost equal. If we don't make it, we die. If we make it, we survive. So I think, sure, there's lots of straight lines. Good things happen along that line of thinking. But there's a lot of discords too, you know. And maybe that's where the artist comes in, you know, trying to help to get everybody on a straight line. Wouldn't that be wonderful? We could get all these politicians in the parliament to agree with the people and go in a straight line. We send them to do that, but I don't know what they do out here, you know. And I hear they talk quite a bit about it.
Yeah. I don't think you've ever painted a straight line.
I have. There's a little story about that, and I can share it with you. I was teaching short courses in the Grand Prairie area, and I went to all these different schools in the whole district. And there was one place called Hythe, Hythe, and there was Scandinavian folks there. And there was one little boy, you know. He was sitting there, and this is the pose he had. He looked around a little bit, stayed like that. And and I was trying to get them to do art, you know. And he had his paper there and a pencil and a ruler. And when I came to him and he started with his words, I couldn't even draw a straight line. And back to that pose, you know. So I told him, well, it's up to you. You got a nice sheet of paper, you got a ruler and a pencil. You can do something with that, I think. But it's up to you, you know. No. No. Just like that, you know. He was ready for Hollywood, I think, the way he was posed. Anyway, I noticed all of a sudden while I was tending to the other students, the ruler went on top of the paper, and he was still at that grudge-looking thing in the face. Finally, took a pencil. He drew a line across. Then he put things back. He did draw a straight line. And I came to him and I said, "What do I do with this?" He says. I said, "You did it, didn't you?" "Yeah." "Well, sign it." And no way, you know. But all of a sudden I could see him, you know, scribble. And then he realized all of a sudden he started "See? I drew this. You know, for a guy who couldn't draw a straight line, he committed himself to do something. And I was in that area about 3 weeks, and quite a few days later, I get a call at the hotel where I was staying. And the teacher said, "What did you do to that boy?" And I couldn't remember what boy it was, you know, because it was... I was dealing with a lot of boys in that old district. The one with the long face, you know, the grudge. "What did you do to him?" I said, "I don't know." He says, "He's a genius. His marks are like 17 to 20, all of a sudden is 91 to almost 100. You know, the child life turned, you know. And so, guys talk about a straight line. That's my story on a straight line. An important... And a very, very important straight line for that boy. It changed his life. You know? So I hope that answers your...
So I forgot what the question was. But I think that's a great story of how you connect to youth. And a little bit about, you know, your past teaching experience. And I think some of what your intent is with your work to empower people, to empower Indigenous people to stand up. I think, so, you know, it makes me wonder what you think about for the future. What are your hopes and goals for future generations?
One thing I want to say to all Canadians is that we're lucky people, we're free people, we have a free country. And I was trying to call this show The Landlord. There's a third landlord that hasn't quite come back into picture, and that's the natives. We're a little bit on the outside. And perhaps this show will bring us all together, you know, as people. We're lovely people. We live in a beautiful, lovely country, you know. And everyone that came here has survived and has done well, you know, by coming into the country and to change your lives. we have the other side, the natives. We're not in there yet. But I think it'll come, you know. Because I have all these young people. These are all my grandchildren and Ibida. I want a better future for them, too. Just like you wanted your grandchildren to have a better future. I have that dream, too, you know. And through the art, I've been able to come this far. I've been able to change the world that I lived in. And you wouldn't believe it. I've never got paid since the last paycheck from Indian Affairs back in Expo years. That was my last paycheck. So I really have to be grateful to be able to survive with just the artwork. It's ordinary people like you, people that bought my work, that helped me through the strange path of success to the art. You know, it's amazing for me to go into that National Gallery and to watch people react, to receive something from a painting. And I believe that I didn't waste my life because I was able to communicate with people through the art. And I feel very fortunate for that. When I saw the papers this morning, I sat down. I couldn't move for quite a while. I was just amazed to see such a colorful, you know, tribute to the work that I was doing. Not to succeed in that sense, but to reach and to the rest of the Canadian public. I've given back something to you people for giving me a freedom to live as an artist, to be able to survive with my children and now grandchildren. And most of them are, they're not educated, I can guarantee you that. They got these little gadgets, you know. I don't even know what they're doing, you know. But they seem to be more quicker in the mind thinking than I ever was, you know. So I see the change. And gosh, today I wish all of Canada my thanks, all across, you know, everyone. Because you've given me something that was undreamt of back in 1965. I thank you all.